have a taste of summer.
Yes.
Please take care of yourselves for the next few days, stay inside and drink lots of water. Would you please stand and sing our first hymn? Let us sing to the God of salvation.
Have failed to do.
life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to Him in faith, pardon you, set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Before he died, say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father. Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him and said, we are here as your slaves. But Joseph said to them, do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to harm to me, God intended it for good in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones. In this way, he assured them, speaking kindly to them, for the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
psalm this morning is 114. When Israel came out of Egypt,
and the house of Jacob from among the people of
the land of Judah became his sanctuary,
and Israel was his dominion.
The sea saw that and fled.
Jordan was driven back.
The mountains skipped like rams,
and the little hills like dumb sheep.
What ailed you, O sea, that you fled?
And Jordan, that you were driven back.
You mountains, that you skipped like rams,
and you little hills like dumb sheep.
Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord,
at the presence of the God of Jacob,
who turned the rock into a pool of water,
and the flintstone into a welling stream.
Romans chapter 14, verses 1 to 14. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purposes quarrelling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honour of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honour of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honour of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God. Let us therefore no longer pass judgment on one another, but resolve instead never to put a stumbling block or hindrance in the way of another. I know, and I am persuaded by the Lord Jesus, that nothing is unclean in itself, but it is unclean for anyone who thinks it unclean. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's stand and sing our gospel hymn.
I want you, that you love one.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew, chapter 18, beginning at verse 21.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Then Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me and I will pay everything. And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. And he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in his anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. For the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May I speak to you in the name of God, whom we know as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Well, today's readings present us with a challenge, don't they? You will agree, I think, that it doesn't take a genius to figure out that the theme of today's readings is forgiveness. The Genesis reading places Joseph and his brothers in Canaan after Jacob's death in Egypt. And after Joseph and his brothers, accompanied by a huge company of Egyptians also, have buried Jacob in the same cave where Abraham and Sarah and his wife Rachel were buried, as he had requested. Now this is quite some time after Jacob had died. There were the 40 days for the embalming of the body. There were 70 days of weeping and then travelling to Canaan to bury him. At this point, I think the beginning of this is hilarious. They realised that Jacob was dead. Well, really? And at this point, the brothers start to worry about what Joseph will do with them now that their father has died. Remember, Joseph did want revenge on his brothers. Remember, he put the cup in Benjamin's sack of grain? He was planning revenge, but thanks be to God, he has grown maturity and grace since then. And in the event, he forgives them freely and promises to look after them and their families. Now, we're all familiar with the world of paybacks and reciprocal revenge. Just think about the news about the shootings in Sydney over the past couple of weeks. That's a world where the strong intimidate the weak, and where fear is a means of manipulating your enemy, and fear inhabits your dreams as well. In the world of paybacks, the first order of business when you get to be in charge is take revenge on your enemies. Make them pay, either with their ill-gotten gains or their lives. Now, many of us know, and some have experienced, wars and dire atrocities perpetrated under this system. Actually, we call that world history. In writing to the Romans, Paul is addressing an issue that he sees
as potentially divisive in the Roman Church. Paul's evangelism has brought Gentiles and Jews together, together in a new family, Jesus being the firstborn of that family. So Paul, having stressed the importance of love, gets down to the nitty-gritty and addresses issues which may cause dissension or hostility, and may even put their communal love to the test. Things such as dietary rules, observances of holy days. Now Paul isn't giving the congregation anything new, he simply echoes the messages of Jesus. Don't judge one another. Do two things. First of all, be convinced in your own mind. And second, keep your convictions to yourself. Because what is important is your devotion to the Lord. The kingdom of God is not a family of clones, but of diversity. And we all belong to the Lord. So we come to the gospel. And what a gospel it is today. Well, might we ask, so how many is it, Jesus? How many times are we really supposed to forgive someone? Just as Peter was asked, offering what he thinks is a grand number of 7. Actually, if you want to split hairs, is it 77 times as the New Revised Standard has it? Or as I found in the commentary, which translated the Greek as unto 70 times 7, which is actually 490 times that we're to forgive someone. Really? Who keeps that kind of score? Is this for people who love lists or who love knowing exactly what they have to do? People who tick boxes and keep scores? Well, for my money, it's not about the maths. It's about the very nature of forgiveness. It's about grace. It's about love. Peter thinks he's pretty generous. Of course he does. This must have been a topic of discussion among the disciples. And Peter says, "Why no, I'll go ask Jesus." And his 7 times is generous. When it's put against the rabbinical system of forgiving up to 3 times, after that, if the person were to sin a 4th time, punishment would take place. So what's Jesus' reaction? Not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. With the implication being that the actual number is unquantifiable. Poor Peter, again. He stuck his neck out and Jesus remonstrates with him again. And then Jesus tells a parable. Well, this is Matthew's gospel after all. And this parable describes a king who's decided to sort out his accounts. Apparently, his first slave, possibly someone authorised by the king to collect money for him, owes him 10,000 talents. Sounds like a lot, doesn't it? Well, it's not. It's simply ginormous. It's an astronomical amount. If a single talent was the equivalent of 15 years' wages in first century Palestine, 10,000 talents is the equivalent of 150,000 years of income. Anybody who heard Jesus tell this story would probably laugh and fit to burst. Of course the slave can't pay. Accordingly, when the slave pleads for time to pay, the king forgives him the debt and releases him. So far, so good. But when the slave runs into someone who owes him 100 denarii, he demands payment. This isn't a big amount like the one he owed, is it? One single denarius was worth a day's wage. Remember the workers in the vineyard? So this amount of 100 denarii is about 3 months' wages, and probably significant to the person who owed it. They're practically nothing when compared to the 10,000 talents owed by the slave demanding payment. And if you pay attention, he's trying to choke his fellow slave as well. So this is demanding money with violence.
In the end, the king reneges on his forgiveness, and because the slave did not follow his, the king's example of mercy, he's sent away to be punished. My friends, faith isn't what we are supposed to do. Jesus offers another reality. Stop asking dumb questions about how much I should forgive, because if you're intent on counting the number of times you say, okay, I forgive you, you're not actually forgiving anyone at all. You're just going through the motions until you get the reward. And the parable doesn't say anything either about we should just keep on forgiving and forgiving and forgiving without thinking and praying about it. Forgiveness is not like hitting the forgiveness button on the screen. Peter thought 7 was a pretty high number. The slaves thought 100 denarii was a pretty high number. Neither of them means anything when we compare it to the 10,000 talents. Jesus used this parable to drive home just how much we owe to God. Here's the thing. We can identify with the slave with that massive, unrepayable debt, with that slave who's just been forgiven so much, and then we can rest in the unbelievable forgiveness, acceptance, and loving grace that we have experienced. And we can try as much as we can to live out that loving grace in our lives. Take a look at what happened to the first slave. He was granted a totally unexpected, life-changing moment of grace, a gift of forgiveness. And he seemed totally unmoved by it. No sense of gratitude. His whole life was changed in an instant, and he didn't even notice. I don't think that forgiveness is as much an expectation of God's from us as it is a gift of God to us. We rejoice in God's mercy and forgiveness, and in that delight, we are more able to offer mercy and grace to others. None of this, my friends, is to deny the difficulties with forgiveness. Jesus shows that his forgiveness was not some kind of indulgent, sentimental gooiness. Some behaviour is rightly intolerable, and while forgiveness may be possible sometime in the future, we need to be safe from abuse in the here and now. And forgiveness doesn't always mean forgetting. It means forgiveness enables us to prevent the memories and feelings consume us with hatred and vindictiveness that we don't need to take revenge. We can move on. Forgiveness doesn't always bring reconciliation either. And it doesn't mean making light of our hurt. It's a really serious thing. It involves facing our hurts and being honest about our pain. That's why it takes time to truly forgive. It's a decision which can't be rushed. Yeah, I know there'll always be people who will exploit the merciful, who willfully make use of a forgiving nature of a kindly person. And we know that those involved in domestic violence are particularly vulnerable. And it's too easy to give simple advice which takes no account of the complexity of the situation. It saddens me, and no doubt you, that the church has in the past tragically misused the concept of forgiveness. And an extraordinary number of abusers have just been moved on to continue their abuse in a new setting, which is rightly appalling. In the very first year of my study, we had lectures about ministry, and during a course in pastoral ministry, there was a discussion about forgiveness. Now, without thinking, I found myself on my feet telling a hall full of people that forgiveness was as much for the one doing the forgiving as for the one receiving the forgiving. Because, I said, we needed to be able to move on with our lives to leave the hurt and harm behind. and that this can be a gradual process which takes time. Well, after that quite amazing to me act of participation, I took time to reflect on the abuse that I had experienced, and I decided it was time for me to move on. The only way I've been able to do that is in God's strength, in the strength of God's immeasurable love for me and the extraordinary grace he has shown me, and in the strength of my relationship with God. Let me tell you a truly humbling story. Remember Lindy Chamberlain? The mother who cried, "The dingo took my baby." She and her husband were accused, falsely, as it turned out, of murdering their baby Azaria. Now, in recent years, a young man from, well, it's not young anymore, a man from Melbourne has revealed on national television that on that evening, out by Uluru, he shot a dingo, which had carried the dead baby away into the scrub. He and his three mates were afraid they'd be charged for shooting in a national park. They didn't tell anyone. One of them buried the baby, and they all allowed Lindy Chamberlain to undergo imprisonment and disgraceful misjudgment. When Lindy was asked about the matter, and the interviewer asked, "If this is true, can you ever forgive this man for keeping quiet?" She thought carefully and then said something like, "Yes, I can forgive him. If he has carried this guilt all those years, he has suffered enough." What a testimony. What a witness to a life lived in God and lived in love. In our relationship with God, God's grace and forgiveness invite us to lay our whole lives before God. And my friends, this relationship is built on love and mercy. Love and mercy that are truly incalculable and beyond measure. And in the strength of and power of that relationship, we are able to forgive as God forgives. And it won't be with a calculator and a list of conditions. Thanks, that's not the way love works. Thanks be to God. Let us stand now and affirm the faith of the Church. What do we believe?
We believe in our God.
Father and Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe.
us pray now for the world and for the church. Merciful and gracious God, you are slow to anger and abound in steadfast love for your people. Hear the prayers your people offer. We pray for the voice. God, who listens, open our hearts to hear the gentle invitation of those without a voice, placeless and dispossessed of all that was theirs. Instead of anger, revenge or blame, they offer in their open hand absurd generosity, an act of transformational forgiveness from the centre of their being to ours. May we sense the integrity of country speaking to country, body to body, and find within ourselves the humility to accept and journey together to become our nation's better future, resolving our colonial memory, Australia's original sin. As Jesus gave his body for ours, help us to receive and pass on this gift of new life for his name's sake. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, we pray for the healing of your wounded world, for the end of ancient feuds, and for the process of reconciliation in our own land. Where there is suspicion, bring trust, Lord. Where there is hostility, bring peace. Where there is injury, bring justice. Lord, we especially pray today for the victims of the earthquake in Morocco and for all those affected by the destruction from floodwaters in Libya and for those involved in bringing aid to those in need. Forgiving God, help us to bring your reconciling love to your world and in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, we pray for the healing of your wounded church, for an end to division, for the progress of ecumenical conversation and cooperation. Where there is error, Lord, bring truth. Where there is hurt, bring forgiveness. Where there is exclusion, bring welcome. Forgiving God, help us to bring your reconciling love to the world and in your mercy. Loving God, we pray for the healing of our wounded community, for the well-being of all those who are disregarded and forgotten. Where there is neglect, bring concern. Where there is hardship, Lord, bring relief. Where there is despair, bring hope. Forgiving God, help us to bring your reconciling love to the world, and in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Healing God, we pray for the healing of your wounded people, for release from suffering of body, mind, or spirit. Where there is pain, Lord, bring comfort. Where there is sorrow, bring consolation. Where there is abuse, bring repentance and care. Lord, we lift to you those in our parish in need of our prayers. Ruth, Grace, Gary, Pamela, Rosemary, Des, Brian, Moira, Pauline, Patricia, Maureen and David, Terry, Doreen, Kate and the family, Nixon, Dulcie, Bailey, Bernice, Raymar, Peter, Bob, Narelle, Lord, giving God, help us to bring your reconciling love to the world and in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Merciful and gracious God, we remember your good and faithful people who throughout the ages have brought your reconciling love to the world. Help us to follow in their footsteps, that when we stand before your judgment seat, we too shall be found acceptable in your eyes and into your eternal presence. We especially remember today, Lord, Mervyn, Bill, Ron and Kevin. Forgiving God in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Accept our prayers, Lord, through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray with confidence. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be
your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from time to time, and deliver us from evil. Your kingdom, the power and glory are yours, now and forever.
My friends, Jesus said, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you. We are the body of Christ.
The Spirit is in us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
To hear this, let us break bread together.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have these gifts to share. Accept and use your power offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom.
Blessed be God forever.
Let us lift up our hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right to give you our thanks and praise, O God, with every knee bowed and every tongue giving you praise. For in you is extravagant mercy and salvation from all that would destroy us. In the first of your mighty wonders, you created the earth, dividing the watery chaos and bringing forth dry land. In the days of Moses, you divided the sea again and delivered your people from their oppressors, leading them by fire and the cloud to the land of freedom. In your child, Jesus the Christ, your reign of love and mercy has embraced all who live, and even in our weaknesses, you uphold us. He was killed but lived again so that he might be Lord of both the living and the dead. Now, whether we live or die, we belong to you, and in gratitude we share your love and mercy with all. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Jesus took bread. And when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Resurrection, glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup, his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise.
Have mercy on us. Thank you.
us pray. Father of all, we give you thanks that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us from dying and living, he declared your love. Gave us grace and grace and grace. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to us. We who in the Spirit rise give life to the world. Father,
we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
Notice us. John.
Yes, yes. Thank you. I have some notices for you, if you don't mind.
Excellent.
Firstly, it's beautiful to hear a sparkle in that northeast corner. East corner of the church this morning. Welcome back, Claire. It's lovely to hear your voice.
Thank you.
Next Sunday is our Mission Sunday, and as it is, September is the Bush Church Aid Society. We will have a retiring collection towards our parish donation to the Bush Church Aid Society. Now, the next item I'd like to speak about is fundraising. At our parish council meeting last week, we thought that due to our bank statements, in another word, we should go out and try and do some extra income by fundraising. Now, parish council would like suggestions from our congregation within the next couple of weeks for suggestions on how we can fundraise. Now, we think of cake stalls, barbecues, that sort of thing. But we need the parish to be behind us in whatever we choose to do. So if you could just talk to your parish councillors and give them some idea of what you may think might be a good proposition for a fundraiser, because we do need these extra funds to keep our parish alive. We have a certain amount of going accounts which we do each month, as well as extra, like this past week we just had the pest control done at the church and the properties. We've had the biennial fire inspections done. That doesn't come at a cheap cost. So we need this extra money, and the only way we can think of is by fundraising. So if you think about it and talk to the parish council. Now the last item is that we know some of us have changed email addresses and phone numbers and even addresses. So if you could, if that is the case, could you please liaise with Jim, who has a list of all the listeners and their contact numbers and addresses. And it's most important that we have the latest contact details so we can forward on any information to you.
So, if we just see us with you,
with that. Thank you very
much. Thank you, Don. So, next person, mission fundraiser, bring
it
home
with you. Can I say something rude?
Yes.
It's a shame we can't applaud after sermons. I think that's one of the best sermons I've heard in my entire life.
Yes. Please say thank you to God, not me. Thank you, Kate. That means a lot. And I don't know what I'm supposed to do next. Will you please stand and I'll give you a blessing?
Happy birthday.
Sorry? Birthdays. Holidays. Anniversaries.
Awesome. What do you mean, birthday people?
Come on.
I always say 39 weeks. Postage and hand, packaging and handling extra.
We'll do a lesson tomorrow. Come close on your couch. Gracious and lovely God, Janice. Thank you for Janice and for all that she brings to our community, to our congregation. Thank you for the gifts that you give us, the Lord, that she shares so freely with us. We thank you for birthdays.
celebrate and have lots of fun. You have received forgiveness. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you this day and evermore.
Jesus is his name. In God's name.
and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Please join us for a cup of tea and buy another book. Can't buy more.